Hello, and welcome to the CCF online channel. We are excited for you to be part of another worship experience. We pray that what you learn here today will deepen your relationship with Jesus. Enjoy the message.
Amen. So good morning once again. So for those of you who have been here for the first time, we are going through a series which is called Grow in Love Series. So Grow in Love Series. And we have the acronym L-O-V-E. So we are talking about growing in love, and it is so crucial and it's so important why we put emphasis on this. We know that the only way to win this world for Christ is through love. So we want to show the world what true love is. For a believer, for a Christian, the test of maturity, the spirituality, and the experience of Christ is when people see that we love them. So when people truly see that there is love, then people will be attracted to God. And that is why we emphasize on this. And first of all, we've been through our study on L, which is love for God. So it is always anchored, it is always founded on our love for God. When we know that the Creator of the heavens and the earth, who has given the greatest love of all by sending His Son, Jesus Christ, to die for our sins so that we may be reconciled back to Him instead of being punished for all eternity, then we are able to love God because we understood we are so grateful because of what He did. Instead of us languishing in hell for all eternity, because of that love, then we are able to reciprocate, to bring back, or to give back that kind of love. God, or we love God because He first loved us. And then we will be able to love others. We know that the greatest commandment of all is to love God with all of your heart, mind, soul, and strength. And the second to that is love your neighbor as yourself. So that is our study. And the ultimate way of knowing that we truly love God is we have to obey Him through His Word. So when God speaks to us through His Word, the Bible, the Holy Scriptures, and when we obey it, everything that God says, then it is really the ultimate test that we really, truly love God. And then, as we truly obey God's Word, we are not just informed, we are transformed. Okay, so we are being transformed from this kind of living to a kind of living that is really pleasing to God. We are being sanctified daily. Sanctification is a process of making us more and more like Jesus Christ. And as we obey God's Word, we are being transformed and we are emulating, we are assimilating that kind of life that is in Christ Jesus. And so, we have V, or volunteer. We serve. A Christian who has experienced the love of God cannot contain himself by loving himself alone or exclusively, but he has to explode that kind of love. There is an explosion like a supernova. It cannot be hidden. It can be seen by people around him because that kind of love cannot be contained. It's so great that our hearts has to explode or it has to expand, and that kind of love is evidenced by serving. So when we serve, when we love our families, we serve them. When we love our wife, we serve them. When we love our husband, we serve them. When we love our children, we serve them. When we love people around us, when we love the church, we serve them. We volunteer. And that is growing in love. And now everybody is dying to know, what is E in the word love? So we will go there. What is that E? But before we go there, we have to understand that all of this is really very important in loving. Because as I've mentioned a while ago, that the only way to win the world for Christ is to tell the world what true love is. Many people will sing different versions of love, like John, Elton John, Love Suffers an Easy Chair, Love Freshes the Morning Air. Love, one that is shared by two. But that's not true. Because love is so unique, it's so exclusive, which is only defined in God Himself, and He wants us to experience that kind of love. So when we experience that kind of love, then we will serve. So next lesson that we are going to have this morning, or our message, is E. So that is engage the family. So our message this morning is engaging the family. Pastor Peter Tanchi, the senior pastor of CCF, outreaches all over the world, and for those of you who may not have known him yet, so he is pastoring Manila and even the entire CCF ministry. So he said, the most important disciple you will ever have is family members. Your children are your first discipleship group. So it will be a failure if you will be discipling other people or teaching other people before your family. My wife is my disciple. My kids are my disciple before others. So when we disciple our family, because we love them, we want to serve them, and we want them to be brought in the ways of God. Let me ask you, do you love your family? Yes or no? Yes. In fact, to prove that, we want to give them the best that we can ever give them. We work hard, we strive hard to give them a comfortable life. One proof is we have so many OFWs. So we go abroad and then earn dinar, riyal, dollar, sterling pounds, or whatever denomination in order to provide for our children, to prove that we love them. Because we want to do everything because we love them and we want to engage the family. And that is a proof that we really love our children and our family. And we want to do everything. So, in our message this morning, the title is basically something that is really very important, which is engaging the family. Now, if we believe that discipleship must first be on our children, what's happening today? What's usually happening today when we talk about discipling our children? We have what we call the secular, traditional, and biblical view of discipleship. So secular, meaning God is not part of the picture. And the traditional, or what we usually see in traditions, and the mandate, which is biblical. So when we say secular, we allow our children to learn everything and anything under the sun. So whatever it is, it may be harmful, it may be good, it may be neutral. So it's all secular. So God is left out. Second, we have traditional, and God is mentioned sometimes, other times, but not all the time. And biblical discipleship is God is central, meaning it intertwines every activity that's happening inside the family, whether during meal times, during vacation time, or even watching movies or eating outside. God is always central. There is that consciousness that God is always present. Now, in the secular world, parents do the discipleship by talking about temporal values, like you must be successful in your career, you have to study hard so that when you graduate with high honors, you will have a good-paying job, or you have to experience business so that when you are on your own, you'll be a successful businessman. So it's all secular. And then another one, in the traditional point of view, Christian values are taught. Christian values. So it's good to always be honest, to be always a person of integrity, to always be hardworking, to be persevering, to be enduring, to be understanding. So all these good Christian values are being taught. But the difference in biblical discipleship is Christian values are not only taught, they are modeled. So that's the difference. There is a connection, or there is a fusion between what's being taught and what's being lived. We walk our talk. So when we say, be honest, if we tell our children or we tell our son or daughter, it's not good to tell a lie. But, of course, we have to be honest. If we tell our children, always speak the truth, then we have to be speaking the truth always. So there is an interconnection of teaching and modeling. And of course, in the secular world, Bible is not taught. Bible is just some sort of a mystical or a fable or a philosophical book. Okay? They will consider it like that. It's not for the intellectual. And then there is also the traditional way of discipling, meaning the Bible is taught, it's just purely informative. It's only in the mind. It's cerebral. It's intellectual exercise, just information, just like reading newspapers. So teaching the Bible. But in the biblical discipleship, we have the Bible is taught, but at the same time, it is lived. So in Tagalog, ipamuhay, or we live what the Bible is telling us. So it's not simply a newspaper language, or it's not simply an information that is only good for the mind, an intellectual satisfaction just to be consumed, and then it's gone. But the Bible, when it transforms the mind, when it informs the mind, it sinks into the heart and changes the person because we will be living it. And as parents, that is a biblical discipleship. And more importantly, the difference between secular, traditional, and biblical discipleship, today, in the secular world, parents delegate responsibility to others. There's a saying in the Filipino, you say, you know, anak, wala na akong maipapamana sa iyo kundi edukasyon. In English, you know, my son or my daughter, I have nothing to bequeath you or to leave you as an inheritance except education. Therefore, I will send you to the best universities. I will provide for everything that you need. And then the university, the college will take care of you. And I will have no responsibility. So that's secular discipleship. So everything that is taught there, whatever it is, all types of religion, secularism or atheism or whatever thoughts or philosophies, it will be given to others. And that's hands-off attitude of a parent. At the same time, in the traditional view of discipleship, we have parents delegate responsibility, if not to the school, which is secular, but to the church and so-called Christian schools. So parents will say, anak, you go there, you attend CCF. Or my son, you go to that seminary, and then I will just stay here. So parents delegate for as long as there is a name, Christian school. So my feeling is I'm okay, even if I don't take care or I don't assume that responsibility of teaching my children, as long as they're okay in their school, that's okay. So that's the traditional value. The parents delegate the teaching, the learning, or the responsibility of discipling the children. But here is the biblical point of view. Parents assume the responsibility. There's nothing wrong with sending your children to Christian schools. There's nothing wrong with telling your children attend Bible study. There's nothing wrong with telling your children attend church gatherings such as this. But the responsibility, the primary responsibility of parents is really to take primary responsibility or primary involvement in teaching and discipling the children. We will not say, when our child will come home and then we receive a letter, there is going to be a teacher's conference because your son smacked somebody and got a black eye, and then we will blame the school. What are you teaching my son? Why is my son becoming a bully? Instead, it should be the school who will be saying, what are you teaching your son that your son is becoming a bully? Because as parents, it is our responsibility. We have to assume the responsibility of discipling our children. So as believers, we should not, of course, fall into the secular discipleship model or even the traditional model, which is good, but the best thing and the biblical point of view is to disciple our children in a biblical way. Okay, and that is now our lesson this morning, and which is to engage the family. Engage the family. So what do we mean by engage? When you say engage, when we engage the family, so I checked the Webster dictionary, and it means to engage, to take action. Meaning, if you are acting, it is visible with the things that you've been doing in the home, your consistency in everything that you say, it is seen by every member of the family. And to engage also means to influence. Meaning, you are not controlling people, or you are not compelling or forcing your children or your family members to do what you're doing, but you are influencing them. Meaning, you are doing something that your family will be attracted to follow what you're doing, or to be interested. He will say, "Dad, Mom, what are you doing? It seems to be that you're doing something that is interesting. What is it?" So that is influence. And another way of, another meaning for engage is to attract. So when people are doing something that is attractive, what usually happens is you copy. There is a saying that goes, imitation is the best form of compliment. So when you copy someone, you're actually complimenting that person because you want to be that kind of person. You see? So if this is really an engaging or engaging the family, there is a thing that's happening in the parents or in the home or every member of the family that the children or every member of the family is attracted. So they are engaged. They are always in a position or an enabled position to do something when the right time comes. And to engage is also to involve. So it's not a spectator mode, just like watching what the parents are doing and then not saying, "Ah, I'm not interested in what my parents are doing. So they have their own way, I have my own way, so we live our own lives." No. To engage the family is children will see that they need to get involved with what the parents is doing. So if they see the parents actively sharing their faith, if they see their parents actively discipling others, if they see their parents sharing and being gracious to others, helping those who are in need and involving the church or serving other people without being recognized or acknowledged, then they will see, "Oh, I want to involve that also." So copying, that is really what we are talking about, engaging the family. So, many people talk about success. Why we are doing these things? Why do we want to engage our family? And somehow, the primary purpose or the popular reason why people would like to engage the family is because they want to have successful parenthood. And to be a successful parent, they think that if their children or themselves will be successful in their businesses, in their career, then that's okay, that's success. But the question is, what about the family? You may be a very successful businessman. You may be awarded the 10 Outstanding Young Business Entrepreneurs of 2016, or you may land in the top 100 successful businessmen of Forbes magazine, or you may be the top scientist in the 20th century, or you may have received Nobel Peace Prizes because you have spent so much time in your career. But the question is, what about the family? Are you a successful parent? So when we say, "Are you a successful parent?" you just imagine this. Because success usually is always measured somewhere at the end of any accomplishment. If you're a parent and you are in the twilight of your years, maybe you have already grown up kids or grandchildren already, and then, of course, along the way, we want our children to visit us, and then sometimes the only way to induce them to visit us is that we will dangle a carrot. "Okay, come here, my son. I have something for you." So our children will visit us when we have something in our arms. But when we don't have something in our arms, our children will only remember us when we have our birthdays or when we have special celebrations or anniversaries. But a successful person is, when that time comes, when our children will come to us and hug us, and we hug them in turn, even with an empty hand, even without receiving anything from their parents. They just want to hang around with the parents. Not really, kailan kayo matapos? When will this event or when will this birthday party end so that we can go home already because I'm so tired of spending my time with my parents? No. They will hang around because they want to be with the parent. That is a successful parent. Success anywhere else does not compensate for failure at the home. So we may be successful anywhere else, but it will never compensate for a failure at home. I'd rather choose to be a successful father to my children who will tell me, Dad, Papa, Tatay, when I grow up, I want to be like you. And then when I ask him or her, why do you want to grow up to be like me? And then she or he will tell me, I want to be like you because you are serving God. I want to hear those words. Instead of saying, Dad, Papa, Tatay, I want to be like you because you are very successful and I also want to be rich. So I will just scratch my head. There's nothing wrong with desiring to be rich and to be successful in world's terms, but to hear those words when we are old, Dad, Tatay, Nanay, Papa, I want to be like you because you love the Lord so much. And when I grow up, I will also instill the same values to my children and even to my grandchildren. And that is a successful person. At the end of your life, the most important thing other than God, is your family. So the most important thing, all of these things will just pass away. You may be very successful or you may not be as successful as others because there are other people who are more hardworking or more gifted or who are luckier, but they are more successful. But at the end of the day, your most important thing other than God is your family. And that is why it is really important to engage the family. So someone says, a truly rich man is the man whose children having grown up and will still run to his arms even though his arms are empty. So many blogs, so many YouTube or Facebook posting, you see their parents are crying, showing something that when their children are very young, they spend time, and then when they're old and gray, so helpless, their children would not even come to them. What's the problem? What happened? Why is it not true that a truly rich man is the man whose children have grown up and will still run to his arms even though his arms are empty? That is why it is so crucial that every stage of parenting, every stage of a family growing up is to engage the family. Involve the family, influence the family. So our message this morning is what? Engage the family. So engaging the family is really very important. Now, understanding engaging the family, we have to look at first a broader perspective. What happens to nations and civilizations when it is related to a family? So there is a name who did a research for 20 long years about civilization by the name of Edward Gibbon. Okay? He wrote a 6-volume entitled The History of the Fall of the Roman Empire. So it's more than 4,000 pages, and he wrote it for the last 20 years. And then he had this observation that when the values or when the family is destroyed, the nation will also be destroyed. So that's his finding. So this is the reason why the Roman Empire fell, not because of external forces, but because of something that happens within. There is an implosion. There is a destruction of the family, and so the entire Roman Empire fell. And there is also another writer who said, by the name of John Unwin, he is a British anthropologist, and he studied 80 civilizations that span over thousands of years, and he made the same conclusion. He said, in every civilization, people started out with strong moral values and a healthy emphasis on the family. And then, over time, however, conservative attitudes became more liberal, and the result was the decline of the society's moral values. So as the values became more liberal and then perpetuation of conservative values were not continued, it was halted, so the result was a decline of the society's moral values. And what happened? The family subsequently deteriorated and society began to fall apart. said, in all 80 cases, so he's talking about 80 civilizations, the destruction of the nation was related to the destruction of the family. So every civilization that was wiped out entirely in human history started with the destruction of the family. He said further, in most cases, that civilization collapsed within one generation of the destruction of the family unit. History proves that as the family goes, so goes the nation. So this is the effect, the long-term effect. We're not talking of a few years. We are talking of hundreds of years. So this is what Edward Gibbons said. In the rise and fall of every civilization, which averages 200 years, the condition, the welfare, or the state of any civilization goes like this. First, it starts with bondage, when there is no freedom yet. And then, when there is a spiritual awakening, when there is an understanding that there is a greater being that controls the sovereignly controls the affairs of the nation, then there is great courage. People will start to be courageous, to be brave against the trials of time, just like the events in Israel when they were brought out from bondage in Egypt and then they went to Canaan. They did not just enter Canaan without war. Joshua led those wars, so they have that great courage. And then they experience liberty. They experience independence and freedom. And because of that, they are able to do things that they want to do, to prosper themselves, to improve their lives. So they experience abundance. And then when there is abundance, morality declines. And so complacency. People are no longer trying to do something better to improve their condition and even their spiritual condition. So if it's not moving upward, it's going downward. So when people begin to be complacent, then after that, there is apathy, there is indifference. People are no longer interested of improving things. If things are happening, if there are destruction on the neighbors around, they will say, oh, I'm okay, they're not okay, I'll just live my life and let us just go on. And then suddenly, it goes down to dependence. People will be dependent on something or someone, just like a drug-dependent person. He cannot move on without someone helping him. And then, after that, goes back to bandage, and then civilization ceased. And what's the beginning? The beginning is the destruction of the family. We will never be surprised if one day great nations of today will suddenly be wiped out in the face of the earth when family values are destroyed, because that is always the beginning. Now let's go back to our focus, which is the family. We see now the effects in nations and civilizations. We go back to the family. Jesus Christ said in Mark 8:36, "For what does it profit a man to gain the whole world and forfeit his soul, or lose his soul?" Or if we want to paraphrase it in relation to our context this morning, what does it profit a man if he gains the whole world yet forfeit or lose the soul of his family or the souls of his family? The answer is, it doesn't pay. Whether you gain everything the world can offer, you may have a name, riches, popularity, everything, and people may be having that desire and they are so anxious to possess or to experience what you have experienced, but behind those facade of success, if there is a forfeiture or if there is a losing of the soul of your loved ones, then all of this success will mean nothing at all. The secret of life, the wisdom of life, is to know what is important and what is not so important. That is wisdom. So when we understand what is important in our life, because our life is limited, we will not live forever because we are not infinite beings. We are finite beings, so we have to apply wisdom. What is important and what is not so important? And knowing what is important, then you will focus every effort in order for you to live a life that is really good for you. So, the question now is, if it is important to have a successful family in the eyes of God, the question now is, how do you engage your family? How do we involve our family? How do we influence our family? So, the question is like this. So, our text will be taken from, or our answer will be taken from Deuteronomy chapter 6. So, in the New International Version, it says here, "These are the commands, decrees, and laws the Lord your God directed me to teach you to observe." So, Moses was being instructed by God, "These are the commands for you to observe." Or in the New American Standard Bible translation, it says, they are just the same. "Now, this is the commandment, the statutes, and the judgment which the Lord your God has commanded me to teach you that you might do them in the land." So what he's simply saying is, teaching is not just for information. Moses was simply saying, "I am teaching you this for you to observe or to obey or to do." That is what he is saying. And there is a reason. You know what's the reason? Okay, as we read, "So that," because, "you," the parents, "your children, and their children." So we have here three generations: the parents, the children of the parents, and then the children of the children, "may fear the Lord your God as long as you live by keeping all these decrees and commandments that I give you." And what's this? "So that," read with me, "so that you may enjoy long life." So we are saying here, or what we are learning here is, Moses was simply saying, so that you may live long life, or you may enjoy long life in the earth, when we obey his teachings. Okay? When we're talking of you may enjoy long life here, we're not saying that when you obey the commandment of God, you will live 200 years, 300 years, or even 100 years. We're not talking about that. It simply means that when we walk in the ways of God, we will live a life to the fullest. You will live a life beyond all that you can ever imagine. Because God says that because he is the God who is the author of everything and he owns everything in this world, he will let you live a life to the fullest. He will let you live a life that is unique to you. That is, there is no other life that is greater than that. That is what he is saying. So that you, your children, and their children, and you may enjoy long life. So we will have the experience of a successful family when we follow what Moses was saying. Okay, so we will start here. "Hear, Israel, and be careful to obey so that it may go well with you and that you may increase greatly." So, again, Moses was saying, so that it may go well with you. So, if we believe that the Bible, the Word of God, is the manual for success in our life, success in the eyes of God, success in bringing up our children, why is it that there are so many people having a difficulty, or there is a need to be compelled to read God's Word on a regular basis? Do you believe that the Word of God is always good for you? Can you say amen? Amen. Then, do you believe that when you read the Word of God regularly, it may go well with you? Do you believe it? Say amen. Okay, now, let me ask you, if you believe it, do you read your Bible regularly? Obed. Amen? Amen, dapat. Okay, so there must be no disconnection. We must understand that the Bible is not for information only. The Bible is for transformation. Information first, then transformation. When we believe that as we read the Bible, as we engage ourselves in the study and the meditation of God's Word, there is always a transformational effect. We will always be transformed because it will become our source and our manual that it may go well with us. So if we see this connection, then there is no problem that our parents would coerce our children, anak, my son, my daughter, you read your Bible, because they themselves understood that as parents, we believe that the Word of God will help us so that everything may go well with us. So, in verse 4 to 6, it says, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one." This is called the Hebrew Shema. "Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your strength. These commandments that I give you today are to be on your hearts." So it starts with the heart. We cannot teach our children the love for God if in our hearts we are not fully convinced that we truly love God. You see, this is very, very crucial. As parents, our children must see that we truly love the Lord our God with all of our heart, with all of our mind, with all of our strength, so that it becomes natural. It's not being compulsory. They will see that we really love God in our conversation, in our actions, in our relationship with others, in our loving with others, when they see this. Because we don't need to force our children to change their behavior. When they see that we truly love God, and then they will say, "Oh, my father loves God so much, my mother loves God so much, I want to be like him." So, when I want to be like him, when I see my father being respectful to others, then I will be respectful to others. When I see my father taking care of others, then I will take care of others. When I see my father being a forgiving person, my mother being a forgiving person, then the children will just follow without being coerced, without being forced, because it is primary that the father and the parents will have a heart that is truly consumed with the love for God. So it says here, all your heart, all your soul, and all your strength. When this does not transcend our minds, then our children can smell it from a mile, from a distance. If we say, "You know, anak, I love my God. I love God so much." And our children will ask, "Dad, if you love God so much, why is it's so difficult for you to forgive mom?" Or you ask mother, "Mama, you love your God so much, why is it so difficult for you to forgive dad?" Maybe he's seen the marital quarrels. So when they see that parents really love God, then the children will just follow. You can't pass on something you don't possess. You can only give what you have. So we cannot inherit to the children something we do not have. If we don't love God, then we cannot pass it on to our children. If we don't desire for God and His Word, then we cannot pass it on to the children. You can only give what you have. You cannot fake it. Pass on to your children love for God, and then they will learn to love God. That's the only way. We cannot expect our children to love God more than we love God, because it is simply copying. Simply copying. Let's test that. If we speak so much that our actions are so easily caught, then however we say it, it cannot be copied. Let me show it to you. So, listen very well. When I count to three, one, two, three, you clap your hands. Okay? So, one, two. Oh, see, I did not say three. You already clap your hands. So, what I'm simply saying here is, you copy what you see. Even if I say you clap your hands on the third number, so same in the family. When we speak to things to our children and they see something in our action that's so loud, they will just copy what they see. So, pass on to your children love for God, then they will learn to love God. Okay ba yun? Is that okay? Okay, amen. Okay, let's go on. So, how do we engage the family? I will just share to you three basic things so that we'll be able to remember this. We call this the three P's. So, first, we have to be proactive. Second, you do it in practice, engage it according to practice, and point them to God. When we say proactive, we're simply saying we initiate. We don't react. We're not passive. We always be the one to do first so that people or the family that we have will see it firsthand in us. So we do not allow things to happen first and then we react. Reactive means you do it first. You are the initiator. And practicing is another word for modeling. So you walk your talk. So when you say it, you model it. There is a connection between what we are talking and what we are doing. And then finally, we point them to God because we cannot force our children to follow God. It's only God's divine grace that they'll be able to follow God. But when they see the parents, when they see the family members are proactive, God will use it. When they see their parents are always modeling it, then God in His sovereign decree will use the things that the children saw in their parents, and then that's the pointing to God. Then in time, someday, God will come. That child will really come to God. So proactive. In verse 7 of Deuteronomy chapter 6, Moses said, "You shall teach them diligently to your sons." So in the Hebrew word, teach diligently is a single word. In a Hebrew word, shanan, meaning to sharpen an arrow or sword or to inculcate. So these words are not separate, but they are connected. Teach diligently, okay? Meaning to sharpen an arrow or sword. So it's like sharpening an arrow for ready to be used in battle so that it will pierce the mark, okay? Or to expand further, to instruct, inform, communicate with steady application and care in order to gain knowledge and skills that was before unknown. So our children, as they grow, or our family members, even our wife, our disciple, and everyone in the home, we are sharpening them consistently with care to gain knowledge that they did not know before. Now, if you ask me, "Brother Alan, I'm still single. I don't have a family." Then you engage your family. You have your siblings. You have your parents, if they're not yet Christians. If you are living with your grandparents, Lola or Lolo, then engage the family. Live a life. Be proactive. And then model what you're living. So this goes through the entire spectrum of Christianity, whether you are 6, 16, 60, or whatever, everything in between, you can teach diligently, okay, to sharpen the arrow so that when the time comes, when they are faced with troubles, with difficulties, with tragedies, they are able to make the right decisions in life. Teaching diligently is like this. Words are cut into a stone tablet with a sharp object, so the word of God should be impressed on the hearts of the children of every generation. So it's like that. You're like engraving with a flint stone on a stone tablet. You're simply saying, "I am engraving the love for God to my children." They will see. Of course, it's not literally or physically saying, "My son, open your heart and I will engrave in your heart the love for God." No, they will see it. That's just a metaphorical statement that we're saying we are engraving the love for God. We are teaching them these things. And then they will hand it down to the next generation after them. In Hebrew, teach and learn are the same. So an example here is Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 10. It says, "Remember the day you stood before the Lord your God at Horeb, when the Lord said to me, 'Assemble the people to me that I may let them hear my word, so that they may learn to fear me all the days they live on the earth, and that they may teach their children.'" So this is lamad in Hebrew, which means teaching and learning are just the same. They're equivalent. So if you are teaching your children and they are not learning, you are simply not teaching. So in school, if you are a teacher, when you say, "My responsibility as a teacher is to teach you the lesson of algebra, chemistry, physics, science, or whatever, and it's your responsibility to learn," that's in the school. But in the home, in the family, when we teach our children, we do not say to our children, "Ang bobo mo naman," or in English, "You're dumb." We don't do that. Or "You're a slow learner. Your mind is slow to understand." We don't do that, because it destroys the heart of a child. Okay? What we're simply saying is, we take the responsibility that our children will learn when we teach them. So when we teach them about love for God, we make sure, or we do everything within our powers, within all our capabilities, and our abilities, that they learn what they are teaching. And that is why teaching and learning are two of the same and the same. Okay, now we have here a bad example with a very good lesson. Why is it important to teach the family? In 1 Samuel chapter 1, verse 3, it says here, "And the two sons of Eli, Hophni and Phinehas, were priests to the Lord there." So we have here a family of priests. Eli was the priest who trained Samuel to become a priest, Prophet Samuel, and then he has two sons named Hophni and Phinehas, and they were both priests. In Samuel 2:12, "Now the sons of Eli were worthless men. They did not know the Lord." So it's so shocking that this family of priests did not know the Lord. So they only have a career. So the father passed on a career to the children to become priests like him, but they did not know the Lord. So anyone who did not know the Lord, they are what? Worthless men. They are without weight. So that when the winds blow, they will just blow away. So a person who does not know God, and when the winds of eternity will happen, then he will just be blown away. So it is really important, just an aside, to really know the Lord so that we will have weight and we will not be blown away by the winds of eternity, but we will have a fellowship that is forever in the presence of the Almighty God. Now, here's what happened. It's so shocking because it says here, "Now Eli was very old and he heard all that his sons were doing to all Israel and how they lay with the women who served at the doorway of the tent of meeting." So they were committing sexual immorality with church members. You just imagine, there are pastors and preachers who are having sexual relationships with their church members and not their wives, and they are priests. So this is what's happening in the family of priests of Eli with sons Hophni and Phinehas. And then what happens next? "For I have told him that I am about to judge his house forever for the iniquity which he knew, because his sons brought a curse on themselves, and he did not rebuke him." So this is a picture of a passive father. He's not only reactive, worse, he is passive. Meaning, reactive, it's better because after knowing that there is something wrong, you react and you do and fix things. But this person, he did not rebuke him. That is not very unique today. There is a destruction of the family unit because of the passivity of the father. They're just saying, "I'll just work hard. I'll just be the breadwinner. I'll just provide for my family. You, my wife, you take care in discipling our children. I'll just work hard." This is what's happening to Eli's family. And what happened? So, 164 years later, during the time of King Solomon's ascent to the throne, and he is now forming his cabinet secretary, forming his priests, forming his commanders, and then they were able to build the temple already. And because of what Eli did 164 years ago, so Solomon dismissed Abiathar from being a priest to the Lord in order to fulfill the word of the Lord, which he had spoken concerning the house of Eli in Shiloh. So Abiathar is the great, 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 great grandson of Eli. Because of what Eli did in not taking care of his family, being a passive father, then the entire descendants up to Abiathar was not able to be a priest in the temple of Solomon. So our lesson is, engage the family as parents, and even not as parents. It is our responsibility. We have to engage our family by being, ano yung una? Proactive. So proactive. Second one is practice or modeling. In verse 7, it says here, you shall teach them diligently to your sons, and you shall talk to them, speaking, when you sit in your house, and when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise up. So this talks about the 24-hour cycle of the day. Meaning, you do not talk about the Bible always. You always engage the conversation with your children with the consciousness or with the backdrop of God being the sovereign, being in control of everything. So when we're talking to our children, when we are in the house, when we are lounging there watching TV or eating popcorn or watching movies, or when you walk and go to the mall, we don't tell them just any stories. We talk to them about God. This is what's saying here. So we practice. So they cannot see that there is a separation between our spirituality and our life. They will not see that you are only a godly person when you're in church. And they will see a different person when you're in the mall or when you are in your work. They have to see one person only. And that's what we call integrity. Meaning you are the same inside, outside, wherever you are. So if you want your children to follow God, you must make God a part of your everyday experience. So when you're having breakfast, when you're having lunch, dinner, or wherever, it should be always God. And it's going to be a natural thing so that they will not be surprised. When you mention the word of God, when you mention the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, they will not be surprised. Oh, what happened to my dad? He started to become spiritual. Or my mother started to become spiritual. No, it has to be consistent. We may not be perfect, but there must be a growing. There must be a sanctification. There must be an improvement. There must be an advancement. And then, you will see here, you shall bind them, okay, the word of God, as a sign on your hand, and they shall be as frontals on your forehead. You shall write them on the doorposts of your house and on your gates. So after the Babylonian captivity, when the Israelites were brought back to their nation, they made this literal. So we'll see this here. You'll see here a father teaching his son, okay, placing the frontlets or what we call phylacteries, okay, at the forehead and also on the left arm. And probably as the boy grows up to become an Israeli Defense Force soldier, during morning prayers, you see here the frontlets on the left arm, and that is being tied on the left arm. And then you will see also the frontlets here on the forehead. So what is there? So just an idea, this frontlet or phylacteries is a small leather case which is divided into four components, okay, with scrolls which are written Exodus 13, 2 to 10, 11 to 16, Deuteronomy 6, 4 to 9, and Deuteronomy 11, 13 to 21. So when they read it, so they intertwine everything. So every morning they do that. So this is a Jewish thing that they make it so literal. But for us here, we don't need to do this. What we need to do is we have to let the frontlets in our head and in our hands is to make it real in our life. We have to live it out. It doesn't matter if you put so many John 3:16 in your nape or in your arm, or you will say, Jesus loves me and Jesus loves you here, and for God so loved the world at the back, so that when you go to the beach, you will see people watching you because you have so many tattoos. That's not the point. The point is you live out the word of God. And that is modeling. It's not modeling with so many things tattooed on your body. Okay? And some examples here just to remind the children of Israel in the frontlets and the phylacteries. It says there in Exodus 13, you shall tell your son, on that day, it is because of what the Lord did for me when I came out of Egypt. So, the parents are saying, my son, this is what happened to your forefathers. These are the great deeds that God did to us. And I want you to know these things. How great a God that we have. And another one, and it shall be when your son asks you, when your children will ask you, many generations later, what is this what is this? Then you shall say to him, with a powerful hand, the Lord brought us out of Egypt from the house of slavery. So this is what they're saying. Every time their children are asking, what is my faith? Where do I anchor my faith? Then their fathers will tell them, you know, in the history of our faith, we were once like this, and with a great and powerful God, we were rescued, and here we are right now. So for us, we can do that same thing. We can tell stories to our children. We can tell them how God rescued us from difficult things, from tragedy, from pain, from suffering, instead of telling them the wonderful stories of Aladdin and the magic carpet ride, or we'll tell them about Superman and the Justice League and other superheroes. You know, these other superheroes. They are good, but the best stories that we can live our children is the stories of our lives and how have we been victorious, how God moved in our lives. When you were sick with cancer, when you were sick with anything that is life-threatening, and then God saved you, tell this to your children. Tell this to your loved ones. You know, my God is so great because I can tell my children how God saved my wife from dying of cancer. And that was 13 years ago. And we will not tire of telling our children how great a God we have. The question is, do you have a story to tell? Or maybe you are embarrassed because there are no stories to tell, because you always want to do some shortcuts on things and you're ashamed that your children will know it. That's why you have no stories to tell. Here's an encouragement. Stop doing it and come to your knees and repent to God. Lord, help me that I may tell wonderful stories to my children. And these wonderful stories that I will tell my children will give them confidence to trust in a true and living God. And then they will tell their children and their children after them that their faith is real and they are serving a real God. Can you say amen to that?
Amen.
Amen. So let's move on. So here again, Hear, O Israel, the Lord is our God. The Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. These words which I am commanding you today shall be on your heart. So that is always our desire. We want to pass it on to our children. We want our children to love us, but we want our children to love God even more. We just want to be a poor second. Pangalawa lang ako. If I will tell my wife, I love you, but you are a poor second for my love to God. In the same way, my wife will also tell me, I love God more than you. That's okay. So if our children will tell us, Dad, Mom, I love you, but I love God even more. But because I love God more, I love you also. So you see, there's a paradox there. But in reality, the more we pass on to our children this love for God, then we will enjoy that love of our children to us, our grandchildren, and our next generation grandchildren, because we have imparted to them our love for God. And that is really the reality of Christianity. That is foundational to Christianity, to love God with all of our hearts, mind, soul, and strength. It is not a religion. It is a relationship. So when we are related to this God, then we will understand what true love is. So how do you practice or model? So here are some pointers. When we have conversations, what fills your conversation at home? Is it all, anak, you study hard so that when you study hard, when you have accumulated good grades, you will graduate with honors and you will have a good job? Or are we talking about, anak, you just give, my son, you just give your best shot and whatever results, leave it all to God. The most important thing is you glorify God when you take your exam, when you study your lessons, when you do your projects, when you relate with your classmates, they will see that you are a lover of God. So do they see God involved in everything that you do? In our businesses, can our children see these things? Do they see you share your faith? It may not be consistent, but do they see this as a normal thing? Do they see your love for others when they see that there are others who are suffering in pain? Do you see that you are not contented to stand akimbo or not minding or being indifferent? You just let things go by, and then your children will just scratch their head and say, my father has the capacity to help people, but why is he not helping these people? They must see it. So how do you respond to suffering when you are suffering? Do we murmur? Do we complain? Do we grumble when we see things? Do our children see that even in our suffering, despite the pain that we are going through, they will see that, oh, my father, my mother, my sister, my brother wants to praise God despite the suffering. He's not a complainer. He's not a grumbler. He doesn't throw his weight around the house. Do they catch you reading your Bible? I use the word catch, meaning to say you are always off guard, meaning there are moments that you read and then they see you in the morning reading your Bibles. Or do you walk your talk? So this is modeling. So when we model these things, I know all of us, remember, I'm not saying with a moral ascendancy over you, I am also preaching to myself. That's why I'm always breaking down in tears, because it hits me hard in my heart. And all of us here are just in the same boat. Do we walk our talk? And that is what the Lord wants us to do. Though we may not be perfect, we always want to pass on a godly heritage, that love for God. So when we love God so much, people will just see it. People will just see it. And the world will be turned upside down. So engage the family. Be proactive and practice what you preach. So engaging the family. And finally, point them to God. You know, we have what we call a circle. Okay? We have a circle of control, which talks about our response and action, and we have the circle of influence. This circle of control is the things that we can control. We cannot control other people. So when they say something bad about us, they hit us or they hurt us, our reaction or responses, we can control. And there is also what we call the circle of influence. We cannot control them. Okay, the other circle is everything that is beyond our control. So the secret here is, in order to influence people around us, we have to focus more on our circle of influence. The more we focus on the things that we can control, then we can enlarge our circle of influence. We enlarge our circle of influence. So if people will see that you can handle criticism in a godly way, you can show patience because you can control patience, you can control long-suffering, endurance, understanding, and forgiveness, then people will be influenced. They will be attracted. They will say, what is in this person that I like to be in the presence of this guy? I like to talk to him. And that is influence. And then when you have influence, people will start to mingle with you. People will start to follow you, regardless of your age, whether you're 16 or 60 or everything in between. Because that circle of influence is so great, because you are controlling your circle of control, your responses, and your reaction. So what are we saying here? Always listen. Listen to my instruction, incline your ears. I will open my mouth in a parable and I will utter dark sayings of old, which we have heard and known, our fathers have told us. So we always talk about things that happens to us. When we have stories to tell about our victories, we tell it always to our children. And then when we tell this to our children, we are actually pointing them to God. We are not forcing them to God. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, choking them. Believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and you will be saved. No, we are not doing that. We are doing it by attraction and not by coercion, by telling them. And then, we will not conceal them from their children, but tell to the generation to come the praises of the Lord and His strength and His wondrous works. So we tell all these things to people and to our children. Do you have stories to tell your children about what God did to you? As I have mentioned, it's good to tell stories around, but it is always better to tell what God did to you. And when you open your hearts, people will really see, your children will really see the reality of God in your life. And then, that the generation to come may know, even the children yet to be born, that they may arise and tell them to their children, So this is really the purpose why we need to engage the family, so that the children will know, and the children after them, and the children that will be born after them. So we're talking multi-generational effect of engaging the family. What we do today is we are strumming a chord that affects throughout eternity. We strum a chord that will affect towards eternity in multiple generations. So what music you play will be heard throughout eternity in many generations. And that is why it is really very important to engage the family. Okay? And then they should put their confidence in God and not forget the works of God. So when we talk about having confidence in God, our children must understand or must learn to put their confidence in God even in suffering. So we must teach our children that there is suffering in this world. We will not paint a rosy picture without the thorns. We must tell them that there is a suffering in this world, so that when they understood that Christ died and suffered for our sins, they will understand that this suffering is in this world is temporary. They will understand that no matter how difficult and painful life would be here on earth, there is always an afterlife where there will be no more suffering. In Revelation 21 verse 4, it says here, "And he," referring to Christ, "will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And there will be no longer any death." There will be no longer be any, ano to? Mourning or crying or pain. So when we teach our children the theology of suffering, that one day God is not finished with us. When we die, when we are 6 feet below the ground and eaten by worms, and from dust we are, and to dust we shall return, it is not a simple cessation or termination of consciousness. Our life will be spent continuously in the afterlife, which is forever. In real estate, they say it is important to know location, 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 location. So it is important to determine when we are done in this world, we will be living in a location that has forever bliss and eternity and fellowship with the Father. So when we teach our children, and then they are tried, they will not be shallow Christians, so that when they are tried and tested, they will turn their backs from God, but they will continue understanding that there is a better life ahead of them. And that's what it means by engaging our children. And let us teach them that God is always good. Oswald Chambers, a Scottish Baptist preacher in the 18th century, said, "The root of all sin is the suspicion that God is not good. God is always good, and He always wants the best for you." There is a saying, "God is good," and what do you say? All the time. And when I say all the time, God is good. God is always good, and He always wants what is best for you, and me, and all of us here. All we need to do is to know who that God is, as revealed in the Scriptures. And here it is, if there is suffering, and we know that God causes all things to work together, so suffering is included and pain, for good of all those who love God and those who are called according to His purposes. So there is a purpose for suffering. In the Christian worldview, suffering is no accident. Pain is not an accident. There is meaning, there is purpose. And the purpose is to transform our character. That is the purpose. It is not bad for us. It is destined for us to grow and to be transformed and become like the Lord Jesus Christ. James says, "Consider it pure joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials or difficulties, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance, and let endurance have its perfect result, so that you may be perfect and complete." So the purpose of all of this is not arbitrary. It's not without meaning. When you suffer in pain, when there is so much pain and suffering, it's not just simple pain and suffering. There is always a purpose, and it works together for our own good. And here's the bonus. "What shall we say then," says Paul, "to these things? If God is for us," so he's talking about sufferings included, "if God is for us, who is against us? who did not spare his own son, but delivered him over for us all, how will he not also with him freely give us all things? So if he has given the greatest gift of all in the history of humankind, what is something that is better than that gift? If he has given the Lord Jesus Christ for us to be in heaven forever, what in this world will he withhold that is good for us? It will be given when it is good for us. So when we pray, when we ask something, and when he gives it, it is good for us. And when he withholds it, it is also good for us, including suffering. And that's what we should think, or that's what we should teach our children, the theology of suffering, so that when they grow old, when we are far and gone already, or when we are in the twilight of our years, they will continue the heritage that we have given them, and then they will teach them to their children and the children after them. So what's our lesson this morning? Engage the family, be proactive, practice and model, and point them to God. So this is my challenge to you. No one is perfect here. That's the reason there is a process of sanctification. If you think that you have fallen short of these demands by the Word of God, come to the Lord again and you say, Lord, I have fallen on these things. But because you are my God and you are the God who is always good all the time, I pray that I will stand up again and I will engage my family. Wherever you are, you may be a father or a grandfather with so many grandchildren already, but there is no such thing as late. There is no such thing as a latecomer. God is always coming to us in His perfect timing. The question is, are you willing to submit to God's commands? Are you willing? Amen. I only hear a few. Amen. So are you willing to engage your family? Amen. So when we engage our family, be sure that you are walking in the ways that are pleasing before God, and He will bless the effort of your hands from this generation to the next generation until your family name will be changed forever, but still in your generation, because God is always true to His promise. Amen. Okay, let us all please rise up and let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you once again for this morning. Thank you for the wonderful message that you've heard. And I pray, dear God, that you'll continue to impress in our hearts your word, because your word is true, and your word sanctifies us, and your word transforms us to bring us to the likeness of your Son, Jesus Christ. I pray, dear God, that you'll continue to speak upon our hearts, not only to impress upon our minds and our hearts, but also to apply them to our families and to our loved ones wherever we go. Thank you once again. And as we part ways from this presence, from each other's presence, we pray, dear God, that you bless us, be with us, let your presence remain with us wherever we go. Bless us even more. For all of this we pray in Jesus' name. And everybody will say, Amen. Let's give a clap offering to God.